Ever wonder how a decision made by some central banker can end up making your house more expensive? I know, it sounds totally disconnected, right? Well, it turns out there's a direct line, a crazy chain reaction that starts with something called money printing and ends with a number so big it's almost impossible to wrap your head around. So today, let's go ahead and knock over that first domino to see exactly how it all connects. Yeah, this is really the core question, isn't it? Money printing and house prices seem like they're in completely different universes, but trust me, they are directly linked. To get it, though, we first have to understand where all this new money actually comes from in the first place.
So the whole story starts with this really complicated-sounding term, quantitative easing, or just QE for short. But please, don't let the jargon fool you. At its core, it's really just the modern-day version of the government's money printer, and believe me, it is the engine for everything that follows.
So what is it exactly? Well, essentially, the central bank creates brand new money. We're talking literally out of thin air. And then it uses that new money to buy things, like government bonds. The whole goal is to flood the financial system with cash and get the economy moving. But what happens when you inject that much new money? It has to go somewhere. To really understand the consequences, we need to look at a classic economic theory. It's a simple but really powerful idea that kind of acts like a rule book for what should happen when you suddenly have a whole lot more money chasing the same amount of stuff. And this rule book is called the quantity theory of money. The main principle is super straightforward. If you significantly increase the supply of money, the overall price of things will eventually have to go up. I mean, it's a concept that's been around for centuries, and it gives us a surprisingly simple formula to understand the potential impact.
Okay, and here's that classic formula. Don't worry, we're not going to get lost in the math here. M is the money supply. That's the part the central bank is jacking up. V is just how fast that money changes hands. Then on the other side, you've got P for prices and Y for all the actual stuff the economy produces. The key thing to remember is that both sides of this equation have to stay in balance.
But look, we can simplify that formula into something way more intuitive. Think of it like this. The percentage increase in money should roughly equal the inflation rate plus the rate of actual economic growth. To see how that works in the real world, let's just plug in some numbers.
So, let's just say the central bank increases the money supply by a massive 20%. At the same time, the actual economy, the amount of goods and services we all produce, it only grows by about 3%. Well, for that equation to balance, you're left with a 17% gap that has to be filled by something. And that something is rising prices. In other words, you get some serious inflation.
But here's the twist. Did you see the price of your groceries and your gas jump by 17%? I'm going to guess probably not. So if the theory predicted all this massive inflation, but we didn't really see it in our daily shopping, where did all that new money actually end up?
Well, the inflation did happen, and it was huge, just like the theory predicted. But it was hiding in plain sight. It was concentrated in a completely different part of the economy, not in consumer goods, but in financial assets.
And here is the huge disconnect. While consumer prices went up by, you know, a manageable 4 or 5%, the prices of financial assets, we're talking stocks and real estate, they absolutely skyrocketed, in some cases by nearly 100%. All that new money didn't just disappear. It flowed straight into assets, creating a massive, massive bubble.
Let's just focus on the housing market for a second to see this domino effect up close. So, first domino. QE pushes interest rates to rock-bottom levels, which makes mortgages incredibly cheap. Second domino, with access to all this cheap debt, what does everybody do? They rush out to buy homes. It creates a total buying frenzy. And the third domino, this massive surge in demand collides with a limited supply of houses, which causes prices to just explode. That is the direct link.
But the story doesn't end with asset bubbles. Nope. There's a final, gigantic domino that's left to fall. This continuous cycle of creating money to fund government spending and to manage the economy has led to an unprecedented, almost unbelievable level of public debt.
And the connection here is just undeniable. The ability to print money has let the government spend way, way more than it ever collects in taxes, and that has accumulated a debt so large, it's really hard to even comprehend.
$33 trillion. That's the current U.S. public debt. It's a number so vast that it almost loses all meaning. But the cost of just carrying this debt, oh, that is very real and very, very expensive.
You have to think about it like a giant credit card bill. You don't just have to pay back the $33 trillion, you have to pay interest on it. And when your debt is that big, even a seemingly small interest rate results in an astronomical annual payment.
That payment comes out to $1.32 trillion every single year. And get this, this isn't paying down the debt. This is just the interest, the cost of borrowing for 1 year.
To put that number into perspective, just consider this. That single annual interest payment is more than the entire economic output, the GDP, of a country like Israel. It is a truly unimaginable amount of money being spent just to service the debt we already have.
So we followed the dominoes from money printing to asset bubbles and finally to this mountain of debt with these staggering interest payments. And all of this brings us to the most critical question of all. Where do we possibly go from here?
And that really is the ultimate cliffhanger. How does the world's largest economy manage this kind of situation? What happens when the bill for decades of money printing finally comes due? You know, there are no easy answers here, but one thing is crystal clear. The line from a central bank's decision to the value of your assets and the stability of the entire economy, it is much shorter and much more direct than many of us realize.